Thank you for inviting me to this very nice conference. I'm afraid that I will not speak too much on discrete geometry because it's not exactly my favorite topic, but I will try to speak of a few discrete things, but there will not be many. It's a more classical convexity. I will treat mainly on volume and on symmetry. Why of symmetry? Because you take a convex body, of course it's not symmetric, but anyway it has some symmetry. The symmetry with respect to volume. Centroid of K, if you suppose that the centroid of K, which is defined here, is at the origin, well, and you cut the body into two parts with an hyperplane, then the volumes which are on the right, if the hyperplane is vertical, or on the left, are almost the same. Well, of course, the second inequality is trivial, and it's mainly the first one, depending on, on the dimension. So the centroid is somewhat, looks like a center of symmetry, where the ratio would be 1 over 2. I will extend this property to some other cases, and the case of equality is, of course, when K is a cone, which I expressed here by some difficult to understand way to state it. Okay, well, it's a natural question to ask whether this works also for sections of K. So you take a section of K, you divide it into two parts through the centroid, and you ask whether the same is true with some constant C, of course, which I want independent of on N. So this was a natural question, and we did not see anything in the nature proving this, which is not too difficult. But then, what is the point here that the second result does not follow for the first one? That now the centroid of the section is no more at zero. There is no reason that the centroid of the section stays at zero when you intersect. Of course, centroid is not too far, but it's much more difficult to compute things when you have not this property of centroid, and you don't know how much it is too far. Actually, it's an open question to measure the distance of a centroid of a section to the centroid of the original body when you are in a general position. Okay. The answer of this question is affirmative. And more generally, we can write, if you take instead of a hyperplane section, which is intersection with V-perp, you can take a section by a subspace. And then you cut the section by a subspace of dimension n minus k dimensional subspace of Rn, and you have such a result. The result here says, of course, that when when k is fixed, this is independent on n and depends only on k. So the result is still good. For k fixed, you have a constant, of course, depending on k. And the result, which I present here, is actually a little bit more complicated than generalized what I said before. You take a n minus k dimensional subspace of Rn, and you take a cone in the orthogonal for the natural Euclidean norm in Rn, and you take the span, linear span of this cone, and you suppose that is dimension p, so p is less than k, and assume that the cone is not measure zero, so that it it intersects the Euclidean ball. The subscript P here means in the subspace it generates, so that its p-dimensional volume is positive. Otherwise, there is nothing to say. Then we have this estimate. If I take the cone and minus the cone, I want to compare these two. I cut into two parts, the parts on the right or on the left, with plus the cone and minus the cone. And there is an estimate depending on P, of course, P, K, and N. And so this estimate, I will come back over it. It's the more general results that we could get. And if you suppose that K is an isotropic position means, maybe I will come back on isotropic position after. Well, everybody knows what it is. Then what happens is that, in fact, K is not important. You can reduce to intersection with the Euclidean balls, which means that the ratio between the full subspace G and the cone C is fixed by the ratio which would happen in the Euclidean ball. So there is some non-dependence inside K, provided K is in isotropic position. Of course, the dependence is given by the B, which is there, and the B, here it's a little bit more complicated because there are two cases. One of the cases is here, with a constant A to the KP, with A absolute constant, and this N to the P, which we'll explain further. So there are two cases, for different values of N, of K and P, which are good or not, depending on the cases. Why did we study those results? Well, it was occasionally in a paper by Shlomo Reisner and myself, we wanted to know something about what we call the convex intersection body. So I recall a few things here. If I have a star body, which means that I have a radial function RK of U, which is a maximum of A positive, so that AU is in K, RK of U is the distance from the origin to the point on the boundary in the direction U. So it's not a convex body, but it looks like the radial function of a convex body, except that it is not a convex body. It's a star body only around zero. And once you have this, you may define the intersection body by its radial function, which is the section, the volume of the section. Of course, it is n minus one dimensional volume here, the volume of the section of K with a hyperplane orthogonal to U. And there is old results of Boosman saying that if K is origin symmetric and convex, I of K is also convex. But without symmetry, the statement is generally not true. Why is it not true? There are trivial examples. And you can try to make it true, but it was not true too, replacing the section through the origin by, you take a section which is somewhat central. So if you replace the origin by a centroid, it is not true. Well, you may say, I will not take the sections with the origin, but the maximal section among all sections which are parallel to some hyperplane. Then it happens to be true in dimension 3, but it's false in a higher dimension. So it is not convex. And it happens that we wanted to have something convex, which in fact, we'll show you after, is not so important, because in any way, it's almost convex. We define the so-called convex intersection body. In fact, this definition of a convex intersection body is a byproduct of some tries we had to solve Mahler conjecture through shadow systems. And it appeared that how do we define the radial function of the convex intersection body? So you take the convex body, you look its polar with respect to zero, zero being the centroid of K. And now you look the orthogonal projection on the hyperplane U perp inside the polar body, K star. And what you do is you define the volume of the polar of this projection with respect to any point inside. Of course, if I would take zero, I would come back on the section. Polar of projection is section. But if I change the zero, because I take minimal volume, I get something which is smaller than the ordinary volume of a projection, which is a section. So this is definition of the polar. Don't forget that we are in U perp, so that it is n minus one dimensional body. And then, what happens? Well, clearly, Ci of k is less than I of k because I took a minimal volume of a polar, and I said the ordinary volume is the section. So Ci of k is inside I of k, with equality for every with equality. Well, it was one of our results. If k is origin symmetric, and the main results that we had at that moment is that now we are happy. Ci of k is convex. It follows from our study of shadow systems and how behaves the volume product for shadow systems of convex bodies. Okay. I recall that the k, the definition I will come, is said to be an isotropic position if the centroid of k is at zero and if this integral, or integral of k of x u squared dx, does not depend on u. It must be observed that every convex body in Rn can be put in an isotropic position with a linear transform. Affine transform because zero. The centroid has to go to zero. Okay. Now there is a result which is well known now, and due to various authors, various versions to various authors, for the non-symmetric case, it's somewhat more difficult to find the sharp constants, but the sharp constants are known. If you have a convex body in isotropic position, the sections are almost constant. Volume of hyperplane sections are almost constant. I mean, the ratio of the two is between C and 1 over C. The convex body in an isotropic position has almost constant section. And in fact, these sections, well, now once it is done, one can go to the hyperplane problem and find a big section. But since it is constant, prove that it's constant is big, or prove that the so-called number LK, which is actually this integral, is small. Because in fact, this thing, the section here, is equivalent to one, to a constant over this, with respect, with some something depending on the volume of K, which is not important. Okay. So, in fact, the intersection body is not convex, but it's almost convex, because it's almost a ball. And so, when we proved that our new convex intersection body was actually convex, we were hoping that it would not be the same, but in fact it's almost the same, is the same true for Ci of k? Yes, in fact, because of the first lemma I have said, I will come back on this, there exists a universal constant, so that Ci of k is between C, well, a constant, the number of letters small c, the constant varies from a theorem, the constant varies from a theorem to another when there is a c without, not depending on anything, it's a constant which may vary according to the light. So I'm not occupied with sharp constant here. For every convex body, they are almost the same. I will come back to the main theorem, but I shall list before some lemmas which have their interest. Some of them are classical, some of them are new, concerning log concave functions, which are the main ingredients to prove the theorem. There is quite a lot. Well, they are somewhat classical, and some of them are a little bit new. First, I define an S-concave function. I say that F is S-concave, is F to the S is concave on its support. Such a function is also log-concave, which means that its logarithm is concave. The classical example of 1 over k concave function is the volume of the intersection of k with a k dimension with a with a k dimensional subspace. Yes, with x in a perp, and then you get by Brun's theorem that F to the 1 over k is concave, so it's a most classical example that which happened in geometry. Okay, following lemma is quite old, originally due to Berwald, and well, not with exactly the same proved by Borel, more general in Borel. The Berwald paper is somewhat difficult to see what is inside because it's somewhat old style, and says that if you have a function to the 1 over n concave, and you define this integral here, No? What happens? No. Oh. There is some trouble. Well, I don't know where. To come back? Yes. So it compares these two integrals with respect to P and Q, and with nice comparison with between involved is the maximum of the function G or and G of zero. So there is a nice comparison and sharp comparison between these two due to the concavity, 1 over n concavity. Okay. Second lemma is due to Keith Ball and says that if now you have a log concave integrable function on RK and you look this strange integral depending on x, not so strange, and you may ask why there is this power 1 over p here and the t to the p minus 1. It's for homogeneity, and you will see the result. It is the radial function of a convex body. It is actually the radial function of a convex body, which is somewhat a surprise and depends on some inequalities on log concave functions of the type of Boosman inequalities, which follows from Brun-Minkowski. And moreover, if you compare the moments xu with xu to the p of f of x dx, you get for p integer, because xu to the p has a change sign, that there is nice comparison between the integral of Lk over this new body xu to the p and the integral of f with respect to xu to the p. For instance, if I take p equals 1 and the right-hand term is something like at a constant, the right-hand term is coordinate of the centroid of the function f in an easy sense, then you get the centroid of Lk plus 1 of p is the same, which is written here. Moreover, if I go to isotropic function, if you suppose that f is isotropic in the sense that I said before for a body k, then Lk plus 2 is isotropic. Observe that it works. I am obliged to add the dimension. So I will have some problem of dimensions, which I will solve like this. If I want to compare Lp of f to Lq of f, this is a comparison. This is a comparison which means what? As you observed before, there was already this max and this f of 0, which I will have to compare at some moment. Another lemma, which is quite old due to Fradelizzi, just is a comparison between if 0 is, as I said, the centroid of f, comparison of f of 0 and the maximum of f, which are almost the same depending on the dimension. Well, if k is small, they are almost the same. More k is big, they are like k to the n. Now I define the geometric distance between two bodies containing zero, the origin at the interior, as a classical one. It's not it's a classical distance. I don't move the body. They are zero in the center as an infimum of this product alpha beta, such that L is in beta k and contains k over alpha. And the preceding lemma gives the following estimates. If I want to compare the distance of Lk plus 1 and Lp, supposing that the centroid is at 0, I get these things. And moreover, if I want to compare Lk plus 1 to Lk plus 2, I have this estimate for some reasons of homogeneity. One needs absolutely something depending on f there, because otherwise, you see that it cannot work. So there is this f of 0 to some power there. Okay. Well, this is a very old result. I don't know probably when convex bodies were created. That when you are at the centroid, the ratio of the two of, and you take a chord, the ratio of OM to OM prime is not bigger than N. If N, then K, if K is the dimension of the body. So the distance, geometric distance, is less than K squared. Using these lemmas, we get this, which begin to be interesting in this area, that you take Lp of f and minus Lp of f, you can compare them. with this big I forgot to say that it is a B function. B of k plus 1 and plus 1 is gamma of plus 1. What is it? Gamma of m plus 1, gamma of k plus 1, divided by gamma of k plus 1 plus m plus 1. Okay. So you have this nice comparison. And if I define the support function of a convex body like this, I will need also these things that if you compare this integral which give isotropy on of a convex body, k-dimensional convex body, then I can compare this this to the support function of the body for every u. Here it is not isotropic. When it is for every u, then I get this is a constant, and then a constant and a constant. But of course, there is a k, so that it's far from being equal. Yes, it, and it's a little bit like the distance from a convex body to an ellipsoid. It's of the order k or square root k. Square root k, and this defines an ellipsoid. And here, HL is between an ellipsoid, but with a big constant. Yes? Okay. Now, if we apply this to u and minus u, one gets again that HL of minus u is less than KHL of u, which proves again that minus L is inside KL. I finish with two propositions. Suppose that instead of being isotropic, the body L is almost isotropic in the sense that this is not constant, but there is an R bigger than one, so that it is between gamma and gamma R squared. So it's not completely constant. But then, if you define beta of L in that way, L is itself between beta L, RK beta of L, the Euclidean ball. But when K is supposed to be small, L is almost, will be almost an Euclidean ball. When K is small, not too small, big, I don't remember. Okay, so thus the distance from L to B to K is less than RK, and this ratio is between RK and 1 over RK. Proposition 2, when I take a 1 over M concave function, integrable, whose centroid is at 0, well, also the centroid of LK plus 1, as I mentioned before, is also at 0. And the distance of LK plus 1 to the Euclidean ball is less than RA to the K with the same constant A than before. I don't see it, but I don't mind. Okay. Now, this is the main theorem which I already quoted before. There are two main points in it. First, comparison of what happens with a cone and what happens to show what happens. I draw a picture in dimension 3. So n equals 3, k equals 1, k equals 2. So I have a line, which is F. The orthogonal of F is a plane. And I have a cone in the orthogonal F, which is here. Yes? And now, what do I look? What is F plus C? F plus C is all this kind of infinite tenth, reverse tenth. Yes? So So here k n equals 3, k equals 2, and p equals 2, because its code is full dimension in the orthogonal. And what happens is that with respect to the constant, if I take the cone or minus the cone, I get almost the same volume, of course, depending on k. But for you will see that further that for fixed k, this does not depend on n. The constant does not depend on n. If k is in isotropic position, the same happens, but better happens. It does not depend on k with respect to the constants which I mentioned. And to give the proof, the function which is natural to use is f of x is equals k intersection f plus x, which is 1 over n minus k concave. And to compute the volume is integral of f over this c. Yes? But the integral of f over this c in the terms which I, if I apply change of variable here, well, I'll try to apply this change of variable. I could not. So it comes to LP of f. And so I will use the results that I got for LP of f and comparing the norm in LP of f with the norm in minus the norm in LP of f, which are the results that I got before. If I compare them, I integrate over C, and the result follows using the lemma that you will find the number. I raise to the power P, I integrate, and I get the result. If K is isotropic, the things are a little bit more difficult because it's not LK, it's not, I need something about P, and actually I have something about K. It's a moment to compare LK plus 1 to LP plus 1, which I, LK plus 1 to LP, yes? And I use my preceding result to be able to compare with the constant CNPK, which is written here. And I do almost the same. I apply what I know about LK plus 1. I apply it with other constants to LP. And I get the results, which is obtained here. Now, when k is large, this is not when k is large compared and k is much bigger, this is not the best result that one can get. I skip the method here, and I come to consequences of the theorem. Consequences of the theorem, well, it is the main statement that I said. Corollary. This is what I mentioned. You take C. You take one direction. So F plus a chord in one direction, and you take F plus a chord in another direction, and you compute the ratio. It is like this, K n plus 1 minus K over n plus 1. From this, if you input k equals 2, so f is n minus 2 dimensional, you get what I mentioned, alpha section, two alpha sections have almost the same volume. More generally, if you intersect k with p half planes, and you ask about the volume, you get such a result, and in particular, you take k equals p, I mean, there is no more e E is Rn, and you intersect with P as planes, you get a good proportion of the body like this, which means that there is no more symmetry, but with respect to volume, it's a little bit like a Euclidean ball. You cut the, when you cut the Euclidean ball, symmetrically, all the parts are equal and proportional to what happens. And here, also, provided the P is not too big. Of course, when P becomes big, this becomes bad. But when P is small, it does not depend on N. Sharpness of the first corollary. It seems to it is sharp when k is small. When k is not too small but close to n, it's not too bad. It's not too bad in the sense that if you take the simplex and you intersect it with the right dimension, you get the good results. In the last part one of the last theorem, also, of course, you cannot get better than n because there is a simplex. And the simplex, if you take something near the vertex of the simplex and you take the part minus the center side, the ratio will be n, and there is nothing to do. Does there exist a better constant if you intersect, if you take an ortant? I mean, you intersect with all the coordinates and you take I from 1 to n. I mean, I cut the space in 2 to the n parts, and I have one part here. What is the constant alpha n which we get? Well, in fact, it follows that alpha n is bigger than 1 over m from corollary 3. Is there a better estimate? We think so. In fact, we would say that a better estimate should be 1 over square root n instead of 1 over n. Well, if k is centrally symmetric, not too difficult to prove that it is 1 over square root n. And 1 over square root n is actually the good estimate if you look the cube, but you take the UIs, not the classical UIs for the cube, but you suppose that n is 2 to the m, and you take there are vertices which are of a cube of dimension 2 to the m, which are pairwise orthogonal, and you take this as a basis, and then you get an exact computation that the volume of k intersection with this cone you are able to see something? Okay, I finish. And this is of the order of 1 over square root n. Now I finish by application to convex intersection body. Convex intersection body, in fact, its radial function is given by this formula. And with this formula, with a minimum of this, but for any term of this, this is bigger than if I use the z plus, the integrate of half of the body. But if I integrate of half of the body, this is strictly less than 1. So my this ratio is bigger than the volume itself. Yes? So I am reduced to the volume. This is the radial function of my intersection body. It's bigger than the volume of half the section, but the volume of half of the section is almost the volume of the whole section. So I get the right estimate with a constant C, so that the convex intersection body is actually almost equal to is the intersection body. Okay. Now, this will be the conclusion, and I don't omit to wish a happy birthday to Tibor, Gabor, and Andre.